Good evening, everyone. I'd like to start by thanking Dr. Karen Fasciano, Paige Malinowski, and Annalise Ryan for inviting me to speak with you today. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Christina Crespi, and on behalf of the Young Adult Program, I'd like to welcome you to the best club that no one wants to be a part of. On a lighter note, the Young Adult Program is a space that has just supported me in many ways. It's a place where I feel truly seen and can express my struggles with no judgment and unwavering support. I feel really honored to be sharing this space with you after what's been such a tumultuous year. I'd like to also thank each of you for being here today, the patients, parents, siblings, significant others, and friends. I realize for the patients in the room, some of you may be facing a new diagnosis, enduring treatment, waiting for scan or biopsy results, struggling with survivorship, or dealing with a chronic or terminal diagnosis. Regardless of where you are in this process, I hope you can feel seen today and know that you are not alone. So before sharing my story, I would first like to recognize what many of you in active treatment have endured throughout the past year. I feel this meme is a pretty accurate representation of what it's been like for the cancer community this year. I truly cannot fathom undergoing or navigating a new diagnosis or undergoing treatment during a global pandemic. The grief involved in the young adult cancer patient and caregiver experience is enough to bear on its own, never mind the intensified risks while immunocompromised, leading to further isolation. In addition to the political, racial, and financial unrest we've dealt with throughout the past year. I'd also like to recognize that for those of you who are facing survivorship or chronic disease, the pandemic may have rehashed or triggered some familiar traumatic feelings due to the constant uncertainty and isolation we've experienced. Personally, the loneliness I felt during the first few months of quarantine brought me right back to where I was during my time in isolation during treatment. The fear I felt on a daily basis regarding whether I was making the right decisions just felt all too familiar. Most of all, the consistent feelings of uncertainty were quite triggering and reignited pieces of my grief that I thought I was finished with. This led to a downward spiral of anxiety, depression, and ultimately a diagnosis of post-traumatic stress disorder. I feel lucky in that I already had an established support system through Dana-Farber and through my own community to help me cope with these feelings, but I feel it's important to recognize how overwhelming this must be for those who are affected by cancer, whether patient or caregiver, for the first time over the past year. Throughout my brainstorming sessions for this speech, the one idea that kept emerging was the concept of paradox. According to my Googling search, paradox is described as defined as a seemingly absurd or self-contradictory statement or proposition that when investigated or explained may prove to be well-founded or true. When I think back, the most challenging aspects of my cancer journey related to the reoccurring and overwhelming paradoxes that existed in each phase of my illness. It has taken years of therapy and mental health support to not only identify these paradoxes, but learn to accept them and cope with them. Coming to terms with these conflicting experiences and emotions have been instrumental in my healing process and remains an ongoing process. I initially found these paradoxes to be confusing and quite maddening, likely because for so long I held on to the illusion, of having control of viewing my experiences in linear ways that can be categorized in boxes and tied neatly with a bow. In hindsight, grappling with the idea of paradox set me free from my own thoughts and perceptions, which were hindering me from understanding what it means to be human. The psychologist and psychoanalyst Carl Jung described paradox in a pretty profound way, I feel, and stated that paradox is one of our most valued spiritual possessions. Only the paradox comes anywhere near to comprehending the fullness of life. Moving forward, I'd like to share my cancer experience as it relates to the multitude of paradoxes in various phases of my illness. Just to give you some background information about me, I'm 33 years old, grew up in a suburb south of Boston, and have been a patient at Dana-Farber for 7 years. In 2015, at the age of 26, I was diagnosed with colon cancer and have had no evidence of disease for the past 5 years. Illness, however, has remained a constant part of my life, and I truly don't remember a time where my health was not at the forefront of my decision-making. I was diagnosed with a chronic illness called mitochondrial disease as a child, which could be described in a second speech, but growing up with a chronic illness inspired me to pursue a career as a registered nurse in an effort to better understand my own body and help others do the same. By the age of 24, my disease was well controlled. I felt at the peak of my health and knew deep down that now is the time to take advantage of my health. I pursued my dream to work as a traveling nurse throughout the West Coast, where I could live nomadically and travel during my time off. At the time, I felt I understood the fragility of life and lived my life to the fullest. I also witnessed the fragility of life firsthand in the intensive care unit. I had held the hand of many of my patients as they took their last breath and truly felt empowered by my ability to care for others during times of crisis. Over the following year and a half, I developed some vague but debilitating symptoms that ultimately forced me to leave my job behind in California. I moved back home with my parents in an effort to rest, find work that was less physically taxing, and figure out what was happening to my body. I went from doctor to doctor in search of answers, yet my lab and test results were all normal. After a year and a half of searching for answers, I developed some troubling GI symptoms that warranted a sigmoidoscopy. I remember watching intently during my procedure and saw my tumor appear on the screen. Being a nurse, I knew what I was seeing. The room quieted in a way I was just too familiar with. I received the dreaded phone call confirming colon cancer the following day. What followed was a whirlwind of tests, appointments, and procedures. After undergoing colon resection surgery, I learned my disease was stage 2, which did not require any further treatment. My team informed me that I would require some close surveillance and encouraged me to take time to heal. I slowly felt my energy return and carefully took steps to piece my life back together. Over the following year, I started a teaching position and was accepted into Simmons College Family Nurse Practitioner Program, and just felt like my life, like I was moving forward with my life. However, my forward trajectory came to a screeching halt after undergoing a follow-up CT scan about a year after my initial diagnosis. The spot was detected on my left lung, which is a common site for metastatic disease. In the blink of an eye, I went from being a stage 2 colon cancer survivor and future grad student to a stage 4 colon cancer patient at the age of 27. Realizing that my disease was now metastatic was really difficult to swallow. My plans were again put on hold as I deferred grad school and took a medical leave from my teaching position. What followed was a second whirlwind of tests, appointments, followed by in vitro fertilization or IVF, lung surgery, and 12 rounds of chemotherapy. Facing a stage 4 diagnosis as a young adult cancer patient came with a multitude of intense and conflicting emotions. First was the overall experience of just being a young adult with cancer. I was at a place in my life where I valued my ability to be independent and make plans for my future. Yet I could no longer work, live on my own, drive, or even make a meal for myself. Trying to take charge of my health while feeling like I was losing control in every aspect of my life was quite disorienting. I desperately held on to any sense of control or any sense of my future, and often found myself Googling jobs, apartment listings, and grad programs while retreating in my childhood bedroom. Meanwhile, my parents were facing their own version of paradox. Once empty nesters, looking forward to near retirement, were now putting their retirement plans on hold and losing their version of independence to care for me financially. I spent most days in my bedroom with my door shut like a moody teenager while they tiptoed around me trying to get me to eat or come downstairs. I was so lucky to have their support, but felt like such a burden and a failure. They always lovingly reassured me that they knew I would never choose this and that it wasn't my fault. And yet I couldn't help but continue to feel that way. So as a patient and healthcare provider, I just have to give a shout out to all the caregivers here today, including specifically my brother, Marky. And I just cannot thank my parents for all of their sacrifice and my brother for his unwavering support. A really unique position in facing my stage 4 diagnosis was the simultaneous consideration of my future fertility. Learning about my risk to fertility as a consequence of the life-saving treatment I was receiving felt kind of paralyzing. How do I make these decisions about my future when I'm currently facing my own mortality with a stage 4 diagnosis? I was fortunate to have the option to preserve my fertility through IVF, but couldn't help but notice how complicated and loaded this decision felt at the time. Ultimately, my position as both a nurse and patient was most challenging in terms of my experience with paradox. My time as an ICU nurse was where I felt most empowered. I took pride in my ability to care for my patients, react quickly in life-threatening situations, and just be a source of support for my patients and families. becoming a patient was where I truly felt a loss of control. On one hand, I felt my general knowledge was a blessing. I applied my knowledge by asking thoughtful questions during my appointments and became a strong advocate for myself. On the other hand, there were times where I wish I had no previous medical knowledge. Due to my experience in the ICU, I understood the gravity of the risks involved with each procedure, surgery, and treatment, and feared the worst case scenario. As my treatment regimen transitioned to a normal routine, I decided to refrain from that idea of being either a patient or a nurse. I gave myself permission to actually be both patient and nurse. I used my nursing skills to care for myself and did a lot of my own port care in my at home and infused all of my own IV fluids. Meanwhile, like a true patient, I was repeatedly Googling my diagnosis, my five-year survival rate, and just hung on to every word my provider said to me during appointments. After 12 rounds of chemotherapy, I learned that my body displayed no evidence of disease and I entered the world of survivorship. Prior to my final treatment, I envisioned myself just beaming with joy and feeling beyond empowered and accomplished, when in reality, I didn't have the strength to climb a flight of stairs and had never felt so defeated. I didn't know how to move forward with this body that betrayed me and was so damaged by the treatment that saved my life. In response, my friends often told me I was inspirational and brave, when in reality, I was too anxious to leave the house. I did not feel inspirational when I just felt like I was merely existing. These feelings spiraled into more feelings about the feelings. I felt guilt and shame for even having these feelings in the first place when so many of my friends didn't have the privilege to be survivors and lost their lives to cancer. As a nurse who's witnessed the nation's health disparities, I felt guilty for feeling upset when I had so much privilege as a patient, not only to have a treatable type of cancer, but also to have good health insurance and to have access to treatment at a world-renowned cancer care center like Dana-Farber. A part of me was grateful for my survivorship, while another part of me was bitter and was grieving the pieces of myself I had lost through this process. What I didn't realize at the time was that the grieving and healing process was just beginning for me and remains an ongoing process even now. In order to cope with these feelings during my transition from patient to survivor, I leaned heavily on my support systems at Dana-Farber. I connected with my social worker and followed up with her frequently after finishing treatment. I sought additional help by seeing a psychiatric nurse practitioner and started medication for anxiety and depression. I immersed myself in Dana-Farber's online community during the days where I was too sick to attend group meetings. It was through this online community that I created friendships with other young adults who just get it. I attended my first young adult cancer conference and connected with new friends who expressed similar struggles, understood my experience, and helped me feel less alone. It was during one particular session with my social worker where I explored my guilt and shame surrounding my conflicting feelings of survivorship. She asked me a question one day that kind of shook me to my core. She said, "Do you ever think that feeling angry or upset by what happened to you means that you're not grateful for being alive?" At the time, I thought it did. She responded with, "What if you can be upset and grateful at the same time? Perhaps more than one thing can be true." Honestly, this concept of coexistence had never crossed my mind. It shifted the way I viewed all of my emotions and felt so liberating. She also encouraged me to continue to just be kinder to myself, and she continues to, just an effort to mitigate this self-judgment that I used to gravitate towards when having these intense feelings. Learning to embrace this concept of paradox and allowing conflicting narratives to coexist helped me begin the healing process. It helped me process my emotions with less self-judgment and more self-compassion. Over time, I realized I can allow myself to make plans for my future while facing my own mortality. I can occupy the role of nurse and patient at the same time. This concept in particular has reframed the way I view my career as I transition to my new role as a new nurse practitioner. I've learned to let go of viewing myself as either one or the other, patient or provider. Rather, I view my experience as a gift and apply both my patient brain and my provider brain in my clinical decision-making. I find that through this, I'm able to connect with my patients in a more meaningful way and anticipate their questions and mental health needs a bit more readily. So I'm very grateful for that. Regarding survivorship, I've learned that I can feel deep sorrow, anger, frustration, and also revel in immense joy and gratitude. I can grieve the loss of my precancer self, while also getting to know and embrace my new post-cancer self. This remains an ongoing process for me, and at the 5-year mark, I've learned that I'm still not finished. More than anything, you all have been my greatest teacher when it comes to learning how to navigate paradox as a young adult with cancer. Time and time again, you've empowered me through your stories and reassured me that I'm not alone. I'm really looking forward to learning from you today, and thank you for sharing this space with me.